Welcome to this webinar about capital projects, CAPEX projects, big and small, several of them to do with modifying factory layouts and machines, that sort of stuff, and done with the critical chain approach. Okay, the outline introduction, we'll dive into some examples and conclude. Okay, the setup is standard for these Marris Consulting webinars. Oops, except it's a 30-minute presentation and not a 45-minute presentation, and 15 minutes questions and answers, or more if you have lots more questions. Okay, if you have questions as we go, you can type them in, please, to the Q&A button, which is around you somewhere. Okay, and you'll get a copy of all the slides at the end of the webinar in a PDF format. Okay. There'll be a survey during the webinar, so you'll be asked questions as I'm talking. And in fact, there are two of us, myself, Marris, and Etienne, who's somewhere, and who's going to be reading your questions and preparing the questions and answer session. Okay. And by the way, I'm in fact a little busy at the moment, so I'm not in my office. I'm traveling with a client. I'm in Switzerland, hence the hotel room in fact that I'm in La Chaux-de-Fonds. In Switzerland, which is, for those who know it, the heartland of all the Swiss watch manufacturing. Okay, so for those who might not know me, my name is Philip Marris. I'm English. I consider myself European. I'm bilingual. I live in Paris. I'm a horrible consultant, so watch out. Don't necessarily believe everything I'm going to say. I began my lead journey in 1984, and a little bit later I discovered the theory of constraints, and I've been mixing those two things together to improve the performance of organizations for over 30 years now, in 280 companies, in I think it's over 30 countries now. And I'm the author of a very boring French book about applying the theory of constraints in factories. And I founded Marris Consulting. Marris Consulting, founded in 2005, is now 17 years and 5 days old. And we give many of these webinars and conferences and so forth. That's just the one you're listening to. And we have 350 videos on our YouTube channel, all about these sorts of topics. Okay, we've had the pleasure and honor of serving a certain number of companies, and it's kind of hard to say what we do or don't do, because we touch nearly any physical product, so cars, trains, planes, rockets, but also things like McDonald's in fast food, Louis Vuitton in luxury handbags. You're going to see a case of in mining later on. Pharmaceuticals, you'll see a case today. Aeronautics, you'll see two cases today. So we basically try to be generalists of industry wherever there's a thing being built, big or small, whatever its purpose. Okay. So what is critical chain? It's a technique that's now over 20 years old, and I think it's been used about between three and 5,000 users of critical chain, companies using critical chain throughout the world. That's my personal estimate. You've got several hundred and nearly 1,000 now formally identified cases, many of them written up. Okay. And it's all about planning and executing projects differently in such ways they go faster, you finish them on time, and all these sorts of things. Okay. The quick description is the following. Okay. Traditionally, when you have a project, which in this case I've broken down to a very, very simple, simplistic example of three different tasks, right? You have to estimate the duration of each of the tasks, and that's how you manage a project, right? So you go and see the first person who's doing the first task, you ask them how long it's going to take to do their task, right? Imagine this is a very simple or simplified product development. And this person is proving the concept, the next person is doing the prototype, and the last person is running the pre-series, getting it produced. Okay, so the first person would say it might take them 4 weeks, the second person doing the prototype would say, oh, I think it's going to take me 16 weeks, And the boss says, you know, this is a really important project. You sure you're gonna finish on time? Yeah, I think I can do that in 16 weeks. And he gets to the last person who, for his task, is going to give him a duration of 12 weeks. In each case, what the person was asking is, when can you commit to having finished? Okay, that's the traditional way you do it, right? How long is it going to take you to do this task? Okay, and in fact, if you do it that way, according to the reasoning of the critical chain, you've already killed your project, right? Because if you do that, you're asking people to give a number, a date, in an uncertain environment, and so they're going to add safety, local safety, to each of their tasks so that they can meet their commitment. Okay, and so critical chain does things differently. It asks people for two durations. One of them is a focused duration, and the other one is a pessimistic duration for a given task, right? And so you go back with the same job to be done, and you say, tell me, what time on average do you think it would take you to do this thing? If you have no particular problems, if you have a full kit of information, if you don't have anything else to do in perfect working conditions, how long will it take you? Okay, and how bad could it get? You know, if things go wrong, how long could it take? And so you give people giving two numbers. In this very simplified example, let's assume that half of the time is focused duration and another half is the pessimistic duration, right? So you've got everything is 50% focused and 50% local safety, okay? Which is the white parts in here, okay? In planning, you keep the focus durations only, right? So you plan for this perfect world where everything's going to go perfectly well, no big problems and stuff. But since you know that's going to be impossible, you add a buffer to absorb all the problems you are going to have. And this buffer is big, huge. It's about one third of the duration of the project. Okay, and that's there to absorb problems you're going to have wherever they are. Okay, just playing around with windows on my screen. Once you've planned things that way, right, you're already planning things in a shorter duration than a traditional plan. You execute, and to execute, you use the iconic fever chart, where along the horizontal axis you have the execution of the project, okay, from the beginning to the end, okay, and along the vertical axis you have the consumption of the buffer, right? So to use this example here, we have 2 plus 8 plus 6 is 16 weeks, so we have 16 weeks along here to do the project in focus duration, and we have an 8-week buffer, so we have 8 weeks up here, okay. And when you execute, well, you just look and see where you are. Imagine that sort of weekly reporting system, right? And you go along here and you consume the buffer. That's perfectly normal. That's what it's there for, okay? And you get worried if you get up into the red zone, as we have here, right? Because if you get up into the red zone, it means that if you carry on this way, you're going to go up here, right? And you're going to finish up somewhere like that. And that means you're going to be late, right? You're consuming more buffer than you are progressing, right? You're consuming your buffer too quickly. So you have a look and see what's happening. You find a solution, you accelerate, and off you go. You finish over here, for instance, which is finishing early, right? What you promised your client or you promised your boss is up here, top right hand corner, with a buffer consumed. Okay, so you plan to finish early, and that's how you get to these strange results where people are finishing 100% of their projects on time. It's because they're all aiming to finish them a little early. Okay, and that might sound strange to you, but that is in fact already how everybody gets on an airplane, right? You do not miss your airplane. You end up waiting in the waiting lounge just before boarding when you have nothing left to fear. That's how you ensure you don't miss your airplanes. Okay, so it's just common sense, really, isn't it? Now, that's a very, very brief presentation. That's what I'm going to give you for today. If you want more, there are lots and lots of presentations about how this works in more detail. For example, there is this series of videos that I've done. Each of them is 20 minutes long. So you have an 80-minute presentation in all, where I go through step by step the entirety of what is critical chain. Okay, so if you want to know more, there's that, or there are many of our webinars in various forms that I've posted over the past few years which will give you all the details you need. Okay. So let's dive now into examples. I'm just going to give you a series of examples. Okay. CAPEX, all CAPEX, large and small. This one's large. Yeah, there's a person here. Yeah, there's a person here. This is a. That's the all crushing machine in the gold mine of iron gold in Burkina Faso. Huge factory, right? And so the one of the CAPEX projects is upgrading this factory. Let's start off with it in a different. With a different angle, exactly as you're going to see through the different case studies. Why is critical chain pertinent? Well, CAPEX, whether it's modifying plant layouts, you're going to have several of those, installing a big new machine or a new production line, moving production lines from one factory to another, from one country to another, upgrading or modifying a series, a whole set of production lines. You'll see some examples. These all these sorts of projects, this is what we're talking about, right? CAPEX projects, large and small. Okay, why is critical chain pertinent? Well, because as you'll see, you can make these projects go faster, about 20% faster, or 80% faster. Okay, a classic of critical chain, we're averaging sort of about 50% reduction, about twice as fast. Okay, sometimes it's only 20%, sometimes it's 80%, as you'll see. Okay. And it takes into account the specific constraints that we find in these sorts of CAPEX projects, right? Unreliable suppliers, co-activity and space constraints. I can't do that at the same place here because it's dangerous. I can't do electricity and welding at the same spot. I can't do that because there's a safety issue. I have to manage subcontractors who come in to do this or that because I need their expertise or I need their help to get it done quickly. All these sorts of things can be properly modeled. And the other point is, by the way, that nearly all these examples are in fact a succession of two different projects. The first prepares the investment and the second executes the installation of the investment, as you'll see with the examples we're going to go through. Okay. Here is a case which was presented, has been presented because it's about 3-5 years old now. In videos, some of you who watch our webinars will have seen it in the 15-year video 2 years ago. But anyway, it's we love it, and it's here because it's basically what kicked off within Marris Consulting a whole series now of CAPEX investment projects around critical chain way, because we were not meant to be doing this. It's the maintenance manager in a factory we were already working with. Who decided to do it himself, and he got these extraordinary results, right? The plan, it was initially 8 weeks and it took 6.5 days. It's a 400 person factory. They move 45 of the 52 machines. These are machines that some of them are only 300 kilos, but some of them are 10 tons with a lot of square meter constraints in the thing, right? To get everything realigned. They wanted to put the machines more logically together according to have families of products produced together. A classic, right? They'd been installing for 30 years. They've been installing machines where there was room, right? And so the material flow in the factory was just a horrible spaghetti diagram. So they said, okay, now we next thing to do is we want to make sure we have everything, all the machines in the right place. Okay. So initially it was 8 weeks, and they got it down to just 6.5 days. They did it using critical chain. How does that done? Well, you model the work to be done, right? These are the different tasks that have to be done. This is how long they're going to take with two durations, right? Focus duration if all goes well, pessimist duration if I have problems. What resources do I need? Resources, human resources. I need the people, I need an electrician, but also eventually material resources. I need cherry pickers, I need a crane, I need this, I need that, or whatever. So you can model the various resources that are needed, and you do a lot of optimization, right? Because this in this particular example, maybe the optimization is the most spectacular. The first time he plugged in and did his model, it did take 8 weeks, right? And so he had to work and work and work at it and see what happens if I do it this way. What happens if I rent some more cherry pickers, which he did, right? He went from one cherry picker to four, so they could move faster. And he did that continuously, and he said, this is not going to fit, I need to do it beforehand, okay, this concrete, the thing, I'm going to do it before I start, because that otherwise is going to get in the way when I'm doing it. He did this, and then when it was executed, it went at lightning speed. A lot of discussion was with all the people involved, right, both the workers were going to do it, the teams involved, the subcontractors doing the various bits, and a certain number of stage clearly identified. At this stage we're going to have these machines done, at that stage on the second day we're going to have that done, on the third day we're going to have that done, so forth. Everybody agreed with the sequence that was going to happen. And of course, big focus on the critical chain. Okay? And for those who don't know, this is not an example of a real critical chain execution, right? They had a problem here on at this stage, right? They lost over a day without moving ahead, okay? But they finished a little just before the top right-hand corner. The top right-hand corner would have been 8 days, okay? But that's a nice little example with incredible results. I repeat, 6.5 days instead of 8 weeks, right? A real factory. 400 people, 45 machines. If you want, if you don't want to take my word for it, there are a number of videos by the people who did it, right, from Safran. Guillaume Bretonneau, who's the guy we should all take our hats off, because he was the one who made this possible. He was the maintenance manager of that factory. And he's done that video and others which explain it. Okay. Change of continent, Africa, Burkina Faso. A gold mine with several thousand people working in the middle of the desert in northern Burkina Faso. A big investment to increase the capacity of the gold mine, multi-million. And just as they were starting to get the procurement done, that's to say, getting all the stuff from all over the world, right? Some parts came from Germany, some parts came from Sweden, some parts came from India, some from Brazil and stuff. Everything had to come from all over the place, and Japan and China and whatever. All the bits and pieces had to come from all over the world through shut down harbors and difficult customs environment, and then up into the desert in the north of Burkina Faso, right? It was a big problem, given the first lockdown, which was happening right then. But they did that using critical chain. And they had to be very careful because, frankly, it's very, very inaccessible as a factory. And so, you know, it's not something where you suddenly say, oh, I need something new. I need this, because it's going to take you several weeks before it gets to on the spot. Right? And they couldn't afford to have the factory closed down too long. Okay? So here they did it. As I say, two projects: one to prepare, make sure they had all the parts on site before they started the work. Okay. So using critical chain purely throughout all the different logistics of all the key parts coming from all the different countries, they modeled it. You know, it's going to take so many days of boat, so many days to get through customs here, so many days to get on the train here, so many days, whatever. And most pessimistic and optimistic durations, fever chart, piloted and stuff so that they could see what was getting late and stuff. This, by the way, we presented to a big logistics company whose business is it is logistics, and they're planning to be using it for a very challenging logistics project such as this, because it's powerful. And then they used critical chain again, okay, to execute. In the top case, it was over several months with a weekly check. On the second one, down at the bottom here, it was day by day, hour by hour, and typically you would have things like, you know, a 72-hour plan task with 56-hour focus duration. It took a little bit longer. And ended up at 63 hours, all this sort of stuff, right? As they went through. And here are the fever chart, okay? With, you know, all the good news, the bad news, and all sorts of stuff. And it happily finished with little, not much buffer consumption, and therefore ahead of the committed time. Again, more videos available by Stefan, you can see here in the background. That's that gives you an idea of the factory. It's absolutely huge. Another plant layout, this one again in an aeronautical factory in France. In fact, it's going to be done in two halves. Last Christmas, over the Christmas break, Christmas and New Year's Eve, they modified the plant layout significantly, and the same recipe and same result. The difference was that when they started, they modeled the what needed to be done, and they realized they were going to have a problem, that they were ill prepared, right? And luckily, the fact that they put everything under critical chain means that they saw that they were going to have a problem several months before the execution, and they therefore could identify what had to be double checked, or full kitting that had to be reinforced, or things that had to be done beforehand, before the famous few days of the Christmas break. Okay, and they had to play around with the sequences of stuff, because again, space constraints meant you had to, it was a bit like a Tetris game. You had to make sure that you could move the machines around without one getting in the way, and not having to move the machines too often, because everything was getting in the way of everything else. A very, very space constrained project, that one. Okay, day-to-day monitoring, buffered consumption was tracked, and here we have yet another example of a real world CAPEX project. Things went very well initially, then they got a bit of problems, then they got and finished up more or less exactly where they should, that's to say, about two-thirds of the buffer consumption. That's good planning. That's exactly what you really want to try and get done in these sorts of projects. Okay. This one here is a pharmaceutical industry in France. Two different implementations of critical chain. One on their largest factory investment, completely modifying their main production line with a multi-million dollar investment, with a new packaging line that was much higher capacity than the old one. Okay, and another usage of critical chain, where they had to upgrade a series of 12 production lines. I'll describe that in a second. Okay. The packaging, the big new packaging line, was going to take 6 months, and the modifications on each of the 12 lines were going to take 3 weeks each. Okay, and it was judged to be too long. Okay, so they wanted to do these things faster than that. So the new big line was done with critical chain. It was remodeled, replanned, optimized to be 4.5 months of focus duration and 1 month of buffer. Okay. And we also used in this particular case a mascot, which you'll see detailed in the videos I mentioned. It's something that you can use during execution, since the critical chain, right, the sequence of tasks that will determine whether your project finishes on time or not, the close cousin to the critical path, if you wish. You can it's only one spot at any one time, and so you can have a big physical remarkable object go down that chain of events. And that's what they did. So whenever they saw this big panda thing, everybody knew, keep out of the way, this is the critical part of the project. They're the ones who are going to define it. So a success or a failure. Okay? We use these mascots a lot. A physical thing that follows the critical chain, so everybody knows, watch out, that spot there in that office there, that is the critical chain. Okay, it focuses everybody's attention. And you have this example here of their fever chart, which again was nice. If they finished off one month earlier than they expected, right, in 5 months instead of six, they thought they probably would have taken 9 months if they hadn't used critical chain, because this happened right in the middle of the first lockdown of the pandemic in Europe, with a lot of huge problems. Right? So they were very happy that it only took 5 months, because I repeat, they thought it probably would have taken nine without critical chain. The other thing they did was this series of production lines that they were all modernizing. It's in pharmaceuticals. I don't know, for those who know this business, there's a serialization project going out throughout the world to reduce fraud. You have to put a specific serial number of each individual packaging box, so that there's a system that enables you to check that it's a true product and it's not a fraud. So that's what they were doing. They were installing printers on all their lines, and that's what they had to do. The initial plannings were for 15 days. They put them all on the critical chain. You have here the initial duration, the critical chain plan, and what was the actual. Okay, so they're different, because the lines are in fact different, right? They're not all identical, right? Some of them are bigger, some of them them smaller somehow through this technology or that technology. Okay, and as a result, they reduced the durations by 24% here. Okay, and everything finished on time or early. Okay, and they could give visibility, right? So when they were doing this, right, and they were going to be finishing early, they could tell production fairly early on, watch out, we're going to finish one day early, so you can get your people back and produce. Again, many videos are available on our website about this case. There are half a dozen, I think, by various people about how they did it. Okay, so those are the examples. To conclude, what can I say, the sort of lessons learnt about doing all this? Well, as you can see, that it works, and it's in fact quite simple. It's fairly basic. You just apply the principles of a critical chain approach, right? There's no specific magic. The things to note are, I mentioned it initially, and we find that it's frequently useful to, in fact, have two projects when you're doing a CAPEX, one which is to prepare it and one which is to execute it, right? Because if you're a CAPEX with, I don't know, buying a new machine, which is going to have an 18-month or more lead time, right? That project, you want to be monitoring it probably on a weekly basis for, you know, the couple of years it takes to get everything done, the plans done, the purchase orders done, the machine is coming and so forth, right? So you're going to have that sort of a two-year horizon and a weekly update, that sort of thing, okay? But when you, sorry about the typo mistakes here, when you execute it, right, you want to do it quickly. And then you can shift updates every 8 hours. And that's the execution of the project in the factory, right? So we're regularly doing one, first a project to prepare with certain content and a certain way of managing it. And then a second project, which is execution, which is high speed, hour by hour, okay? I cannot emphasize to what extent preparation is important. It's true in critical chain in general, right? Because you're going to actually execute the plan, and therefore you should spend a lot more time preparing, making sure you've got everything, you thought of everything, you've got all the resources, you've got your full kit, and so prepare. None of this could have happened if it hadn't been properly prepared, right? The optimization of these schedules is absolutely key. Playing around, because you know that the project will be executed according to your plan, right? So it's worth investing time to see if I can't change the sequence, do this, add a person, add a machine, do something different, okay? And also, we often use, I don't know, this is the right analogy, but let's call it the SMED principle, single minute exchange of die, right? Are there things that I can take out of that project and do before, in particular civil works, the concrete drying, all that sort of stuff? Maybe I can do that before I start. If I change the way I do this or that, maybe I can speed up that task with better tooling or a different way of doing it. Okay? So that strange optimization, right, where you're capable of going from 8 weeks to 2 weeks, that sort of thing. There are a number of techniques used to do that. Again, an obvious thing, nothing to do with critical chain, but if you want these sorts of projects to happen correctly, you really need to get people who are on the shop floor involved, of the suppliers as well, the subcontractors, everybody's going to be concerned to be involved in designing the plan and, of course, in discussing the execution, looking at the fever chart every day and whatever. Okay. It's a completely collective thing, as all these sorts of projects are. It's not just within the company, I repeat, with suppliers, with contractors, and so forth. Okay. And for the shop floor layout ones, another little trick we always use is have a daily image of what the target is going to be. On Wednesday, we should have that machine there, that machine here, that machine there, that machine there, and stuff, so that you know where you're heading. Okay. And just to conclude, the results are unbelievable, would you not say? I mean, when Guillaume did his 6.5 days, I didn't believe it was possible, in fact. I mean, I knew the factory well, and I didn't think you could do that sort of thing in 6.5 days, which seemed too much, but he did it, right? So that's given us ambition to keep trying to speed up these things, and we're getting lots of fun, very fast results. Okay, if you want to learn more about these critical chain CAPEX projects, okay, we do training sessions on the subject, either in-house or online. In fact, there's a session in 5 weeks' time in English online that I will be hosting from the 10th to the 12th of May, 3 sessions, 2.5 hours each, at the same time as this webinar, right? So it's compatible normally with both Europe, Africa in the afternoon, or the Americas in the morning. Okay, that's our classic critical chain training in May. The other thing you can consider is our popular 2-day diagnostic and action plans. What we do to kick off these sorts of assignments that you've seen is very simple. We go in and do a one and a half day diagnostic of what needs to be done, and then the second day we present the action plan and we do very quickly. Okay, and lots of other stuff, all our videos, all these that you can watch, over 100 on critical chain, sorry, that's another bug there. There are 350 videos, over 100 of them are on the subject of critical chain. And that's it from me. Are there any questions?